Subscribe the Unique Academy's YouTube channel and press the bell icon for latest updates and videos.
Hello friends, welcome back to the second part of our discussion of American Revolution. In our first part, we had seen the backdrop in which the American Revolution took place. We also saw the course of the American Revolution. And in this particular video, we are going to continue our discussion regarding the grudges of Americans, the significance of the revolution, contribution of political thinkers, and finally, we will take a note of the contribution of America's founding fathers. Let us start our discussion. Amongst the grudges of Americans, the first one was British mercantilism. Basically, this philosophy meant that British trade had to be prioritized by the colonies. In fact, colonies were created in the first place to serve as basically sources of raw material and outlets for the finished goods of the metropole. This naturally subjugated the economies of the colonies to Britain's economy. This was naturally seen as being unjust by the American colonists. Second issue is a corollary of British mercantilism, and that is control over shipping. British enforced control over shipping for trade between American colonies and other parts of the world. It was compulsory on the colonies to use British shipping for whatever trade-related activities they did. This naturally compromised the interest of American colonies and hampered their trade. Third issue was custom duties. All the goods that were supposed to be sent to the American colonies had to be first routed to British ports. Customs duties were levied on these goods and only then they could be sent onwards to the colonies. This not only increased the cost of these goods, but also was a loss to Americans since that custom duty could have very well be earned by these colonies. Further, Britain, which was going through a rapid phase of industrialization, did not really want the colonies to industrialize. Colonists, on the other hand, had developed interest in developing their own industries, which was being compromised by regulations of Britain. After the Seven-Year War, Britain had excessively increased the taxation and also given up on the earlier policy of salutary neglect. Therefore, Americans saw this as a measure to actually make the colonies pay for Britain's expenditure in the course of the war. This was again resented by the colonies. And lastly, taxation or legislation without representation. It was seen as patently unfair that the British Parliament was passing laws and imposing taxes on the colonies whilst they did not have any kind of representation in the British Parliament. This was seen something that was contrary to the development of democracy that was taking place within England itself. Now friends, let us take a look at the contribution of political thinkers that enabled the American Revolution and fashioning of the new state of United States of America. First important thinker is John Locke. John Locke gave the idea of natural rights. It means that every citizen or every human being has certain inalienable rights. These inalienable rights are given to that person on account of his being human being, that is the creator himself has given him these rights. And since the creator has given these rights are considered as inalienable, that is the state cannot take them away. This political thought given during the course of Enlightenment naturally inspired the American colonial leaders to actually create a state based on this. Therefore, we see that in the Declaration of Independence, the conscious choice of words, right to life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness has been used. Clearly, it was inspired by the thoughts of John Locke. Then, Montesquieu's idea of separation of powers actually sees its clear reflection in the kind of state that the founding fathers created. They created three different wings of the state: executive, legislature, and an independent judiciary. This is also linked to the thoughts of Locke. If the inalienable rights had to be preserved, there was a need for a neutral referee, which will not be linked to the executive. And therefore, the need for an independent judiciary is felt, which can then keep checks and balances on the other wings of the state. After Montesquieu, the next thinker is Voltaire. Voltaire's idea of separation of state and church is seen in the new state that is built after the revolution. Although most of these founding fathers were devout Christians, they did not create a theocratic state. They largely kept it separate from their personal belief. This clearly is another reflection of the thought of Enlightenment. Rousseau's consent of the governed clearly resonated with these colonies. Rousseau had said that unless there is a consent of those who are being governed, the state does not have moral legitimacy. America's founding father, Thomas Jefferson, extends this concept and gives the colonies the right to rebel. So if there is no concern, though no consent of the governed, then naturally the colonies have the right to rebel against the metropole. Thomas Paine is another intellectual who enabled people of America to take the final decision of severing its ties with Britain. A British citizen himself, Thomas Paine traveled to America, and just before the war, he wrote a famous essay called as Common Sense. In this essay, he made a very persuasive case as how illogical it was for a small country across the Atlantic to rule all of these 13 massive colonies. His pertinent arguments actually convinced a lot of fence-sitters. Those who were in a dilemma whether the colonists should go the full distance and cut off their ties with Britain were actually encouraged with these arguments given by Thomas Paine. The ideas of liberalism and republicanism that were given during Enlightenment clearly find a reflection in the kind of nation as well as society that the revolution gave. It created a republican country, a republic, which basically was a death blow to the idea of absolute monarchy. It was also a strong assault on the idea of birth-based privileges. Dear friends, understand this in the context of the times when this revolt takes place, when this revolution takes place. This is the time when Europe is at the almost peak of absolute monarchy. It is not a coincidence that just a few years later, the French Revolution takes place in 1789. The king, Louis XVI, is killed, and in 1793, a republic is created. Here is the reflection of ideals of enlightenment. Now, friends, let us see the overall significance of the American Revolution. It was the first successful rebellion by a colony. Naturally, it created a precedent which inspired many other colonies then to rebel against the metropole. Second, it gave birth to a very powerful nation. In the years to come, America went on to become a superpower, and especially after the Second World War, it has continued to influence international geopolitical order. Third, it supported or created the environment for republicanism. This, as we discussed, was a blow to divine rights monarchy and also aristocratic privileges of the nobles. This again must be seen contextually. The context of Europe's absolute monarchies and birth-based privileges is pertinent here. Then it gave the idea of separation of powers, so that the state does not become so all-powerful that it takes away certain basic rights of the citizens. This idea of separation of powers was very, very important. The American Revolution, after its success, creates a state who is modeled on this separation of power. It created a very elaborate system of checks and balances so that mutually all the wings of the state would be kept under control. It gave the idea of fundamental rights. In 1791, the first amendment was done to the American Constitution and the Bill of Rights was added. This Bill of Rights gave certain rights guaranteed in the Constitution of America itself. These included speech, press, religion, justice, among many others. This was that hard and fast commitment of the founding fathers of America to the humanist values that had inspired the American Revolution. It created a new kind of federal polity based on its unique situation. Since these colonies had a virtually independent political trajectory before the war, it necessitated a kind of a compromise where power was shared between the federal government and the colonies. And this led to a very unique model, which we today famously know as the federal polity. It also gave a presidential form of democracy, which was very much important to maintain the unity of all of these new states. Then creation of USA helped further foster the idea of anti-colonialism. America, or United States of America, gave both material as well as moral support to the colonies who wished to stand up against their metropole. America then invited people from all over the world to actually come and contribute in nation building and become citizens of this new nascent country. People from all over the world went to USA, and it truly became what it is called today as a melting pot of races. This inspired many other nationalities to not only stand up against unjust rule, but also create a new state, which is that of a liberal welfare democracy. Ultimately, we must also take a note that there is certain criticism that can be meted at this particular revolution. Although the revolution has humanist values at its center and also attempts to create a state based on those values, these values were not perfectly extended to all sections of the society. Unfortunately, the blacks and women had to suffer for many more decades before they could get some semblance of equality in this new country. Now, friends, let us move on to the discussion on contribution of some important founding fathers of America. The first and the most important name that comes over here is the hero of the American Revolution, George Washington. An inspiring leader, an upright gentleman, a planter, an army officer, there are many facets to his personality. He bravely led the American forces, and despite reverses and losses, he kept his tenacity intact and kept on fighting the British regular forces. Ultimately, as luck would have it, Lord Cornwallis, who was himself a great military general, was outdone at the Battle of Yorktown, and finally, the British capitulated. He also became the chief of the Constitutional Convention, which drafted the Constitution. He went on to become, as we all know, the first president of the United States of America. He was so popular that he was elected as the second term also as president of America, but he declined to contest for the third time. That then became a precedent, after which American presidents did not go for their third term, the only exception being F.D. Roosevelt, who actually served a third term because of the tumultuous period of the World War II. During the initial years after America's creation, George Washington played the important role of the consolidator. He followed a policy of neutrality to keep this nascent country out of international geopolitics. It served it well in the initial years. The second founding father is John Adams. The first vice president and second president of America, John Adams basically ensured that the Continental Congress decided on finally severing its ties with Britain. His forceful arguments at the Second Continental Congress ensured that the colonists adopted the Declaration of Independence. He was also very important. He played a very important role in the Treaty of Paris and also ensured that the French help from Louis XVI reached America during the course of war. The third and very important personality in the American Revolution is Thomas Jefferson. Thomas Jefferson was a great thinker, a leader who participated in both the Continental Congresses. He again also played a very important role in ensuring that the colonies decide to sever the ties with England. He was the head of the committee that drafted the Declaration of Independence. It is his persuasiveness that is reflected in that Declaration of Independence, which is kind of an essay which Americans are submitting before the world as to why they are severing their ties with England. He went on to become the first Secretary of State for America and later the third President of USA. After him, the next gentleman is James Madison. James Madison became the fourth President of America and he had served the American Revolution quite well. He participated in the Second Continental Congress and he was also instrumental in basically reaching out to other countries, France in particular, to help out during the course of revolution. Then comes Mr. Benjamin Franklin. He is basically versatility personified. Benjamin Franklin wears many hats. He is a printer, he is a technocrat, a businessman, a diplomat, a writer, a political thinker, and many more such hats he wears. Benjamin Franklin is also referred to as the first American. Because of his very emphatic arguments that he presented regarding unification of the colonies, he is often referred to as the first American. He was the ambassador of USA to France, and he ensured that again, France and other countries helped America in the course of revolution. The next founding father is Alexander Hamilton, who went on to occupy some important posts even after the revolution. And lastly, we have the great radical leader, Samuel Adams. Samuel Adams was the person who founded the Sons and Daughters of Liberty. He was also behind the Committee of Correspondence that we had seen initially. The Boston Tea Party that we discussed was also the brainchild of Samuel Adams. All of these gentlemen, through their unique experience, talent, and contribution, created and shaped the course of American history during and after the Revolution. Friends, this concludes our discussion on the American Revolution. I hope you found it helpful. Thank you very much.